Hey everybody, welcome back to A Better Computer. My name is Matt, and we're starting on the screen share, which you know means it's going to be a quick-paced video. So let's just jump into a whole bunch of little tips and tricks that I really enjoy about the Mac. Hopefully you'll learn something new. If you do, leave a like down below. Thank you so much. Let's jump into it. So the first thing, if you are a Windows user, if you're used to Windows, you may not know that renaming files on macOS is super awesome. I've got this file open in preview. Let me even go in to edit it. Let's go ahead and start marking it up, drawing on it and everything. Cool. But like over in the Finder, let's make this car. Cool. It's changed over here. No big deal. I can keep editing it. I'll save my changes and quit. Here it is. It's renamed. All the changes are there. No issues. You can just rename files whenever you want, even if they're open. Next up is navigating the file system. So I've got a folder open here called specimen files. Where am I in the system? Easy to find out. Go to view, go to show path bar, and now at the bottom you're gonna see down here in every single view in the Finder where you are. And if you ever want to just like quickly go up a level, hit command up to go up. You can go up again. You can kind of move around. If you decide, hey, I want to go into this folder, you don't have to use your keyboard or anything, or you don't have to use your mouse, I should say, use the keyboard. Command down lets you go into the thing you have selected. All works really well, and you'll find yourself moving around the system a lot faster. Another cool thing is the info panel. So you may know you can right click on a file and say get info. And that's going to give you a bunch of information about whatever file that is. You can also, of course, select and hit command I. That's going to be fine. If we select these kind of like, we'll select these files, hit command I on those, you get a whole bunch of windows, right? And you can take a look at each one and then close them. But if you hit command option I, you actually get this one hovering info panel that will update as you select and deselect different things. So if I want to go to like my home folder, and I'll show you how to do that very quickly in a second, I can click on any of these folders and see how big they are. And I can use this, the most common use case I have for this is going into a folder like my movies folder and seeing what's taking up space and what I can get rid of. So if you want to just kind of like have an info panel that updates as you kind of move around, you can use this command option I. And you may have noticed as I move from folder to folder, things look different. To control how any folder looks, hit command J, and that's going to bring up this page, which will give you a whole bunch of options to customize look and feel. How do you want to group things? How do you want to sort them in the list? You can change the size of things. You can see I have the icon size turned up. The default is this. I kind of like the big one. You can set all these different things and then hit use as defaults. So every new folder by default will use this view. Anything you've customized will keep its customization, but you can set a new default here. Next, let's go into the system settings app. So we're just going to type system and it's going to pull up. So system settings is where you can change all of your Mac settings. You know that already. Here's a couple things I recommend you take a look at. Go to general, go to login items, and you can check to see what apps open at login. So I have a really small list here with just a few things that I just want always available. And then there's some other things down here of things that have added themselves to the login items. Apps are able to do this on macOS. They don't need your permission to do this. So a lot of apps will do this for you. And it's pretty annoying, honestly. So you can see I've turned off Steam, Wireshark, Zoom. These have all Google's updater. These have all like automatically added themselves to launch when I start my computer. I don't want those. So I've turned them off here. Check this out. Make sure everything that's launching automatically is stuff you actually want and turn off the things you don't want. Also, if you're accessing your Mac from other computers on your local network, there's a couple things I recommend hitting in sharing. So I have file sharing and screen sharing enabled, and basically what these will mean is that on my other computers, including Windows computers, I'm able to access this computer. So file sharing, if I hit the info button next to this, you can see I have a couple public folders, not everything, just kind of a Dropbox folder in my home directory, where if you authenticate as me, you can read as write, and everyone else in the network can just see this folder, and you can see here's the address I would go to on a, like a Windows computer. On Mac computers or iOS devices, if you're all signed into the same iCloud account, you should just see it. But this lets other people or other non-Apple devices access, and you can add specific folders, directories, whole lots to do here. This could probably be a whole separate video, but this is really nice. Next, let's go to sound, and there's two things I would check in sound. Number one is your alert sound. So the default is this kind of like boop thing. And if you've been using a Mac for 10, 20, 30 years, you've heard this so many times. I've changed mine to Pebble. I think Pebble's fun. There's some other ones here. If you want a different alert sound, I recommend changing it. It's surprising how delightful that can make just using your Mac a little bit to just change that one tiny thing. And then the other thing is play sound at startup. This is on for me. That's the kind of bong that plays when you start up your computer. If you don't want that for whatever reason, either you have just no joy and don't want it, or because you open your computer or you turn on your computer, I should say, in environments where maybe that would be obnoxious to other people, you can turn that off here in the sound settings. Next up is a new one I didn't actually know about until like literally starting researching this video. If you go into the battery settings, there's low power mode, which can be turned on manually when you hit 20%. But if you just want it always running because you have more power than you need for basically everything, you can just turn it on to always. I'm going to have it turned on to always for the rest of this video. My typical use case is actually to have it on for battery only, so that when I'm on battery, I don't get the full power of my computer, but Apple Silicon has so much overhead for most of the things that I'm doing, it's totally fine. So check this out if you want more battery life out of your Mac. For this next one, we're going to bring up text edit, and I've got some text in here already, which is great. And let's go into my keyboard settings. So one thing that drives me crazy about macOS by default is the key repeat rate is like here or something by default, which is just like so slow and drives me crazy because sometimes I do want to type in a bunch of letters really quickly and this is so slow, like it's barely moving. That's relatively shocking. I turned this all the way up. And now if I hold down the spacebar, it's just gonna go crazy. And I like that quite a bit more. So that's a really nice thing to do. Additionally, if you want to do some basic text replacement, there's a text replacements feature here. And these sync between your devices. So all your Apple devices will sync these. So you can do these on your phone, your iPad as well. But I have a couple here. So if we go ahead and type SSHRUG, it's going to recommend that. Hit the down arrow and there we go. I've got that guy. OMW I think is on by default on macOS. There you go, on my way. And so you can do these, you can create them. You just type whatever text you want, QWE, and we'll do RTY, right? So this is a stupid one, but QWE, RTY. Cool, love this. If you just want to have a free and basic way to do text replacement. I use Keyboard Maestro for this, but this is built into macOS and again, syncs between your devices, which is really nice. Okay, next up is keyboard shortcuts, and I've got a whole bunch of things here. So one thing that really impresses people when they see me do it the first time is navigating around text. So you can arrow around text, right? One character, one line at a time. But I find myself almost always having my other hand over on the Option key. And with the Option key held down, you'll move one word at a time. And you can hold down Shift to select one word at a time. This is awesome. This is great. If I hit down, that's going to take me to the bottom of the paragraph. This will take me to the next one. And basically, this will be like from line to line, or paragraph to paragraph, I should say. So really love these, and these also work with the command. So command will take you, if you hit left, all the way to the start of the line, hit right, all the way to the end of it. If you hit down, all the way to the bottom of the document, up, all the way to the top. And again, if you hold shift, you can also select that way as well. So that lets you navigate text a lot quicker. Again, option, holding option down will go one word or one paragraph at a time, whether you're going up or down. And then holding command will go all the way to the end, start, or whatever, basically all the way to the top, bottom, right, or left of whatever you're looking at. Now you might have noticed the dock is not on my screen. Normally it's on the left side. If I want to show it briefly, I can hit Command Option D. That brings up the dock. If I hit that again, it hides the dock. So quickly toggle your dock like that. And if I want to hide and show invisible files, that's actually Command Shift Period. And now you can see I have this .tmp drive downloaded, which has nothing in it. I don't really know what that is. But every once in a while, if you need to find invisible files, you can just hit that keyboard shortcut. And to hide them again, Command Shift Period again. And now it's gone. Okay, so now we're in the Finder, and let's just do some keyboard shortcuts to bring up common folders. If I want to bring up my Applications folder, it's Command-Shift-A. And here's all my applications, right? If I want to switch to my Home folder, Command-Shift-H. If I want to go to my Desktop, Command-Shift-D. If I want to go to my Downloads folder, this one's a little weird, it's Command-Option-L. I don't know exactly why that's it, but if I want to go to my Documents folder, Command-Shift-O. They've kind of run out of characters, right? But yeah, that's how you go to these common folders. Command-Shift-M, where does that take me to? Nowhere. But you also have this Go menu up here. All the keyboard shortcuts are up here if you want to see how you get to some of the common ones on your computer. I should also say that if you're in a save dialog, so let's go back to this text file. If I hit save, I can actually quickly save it to the desktop with Command Shift D. I can save it to documents with O. Hit D, there we go, save it, and it's saved to my desktop. So those keyboard shortcuts work anywhere it's showing you your file system. Okay, three more quick ones to wrap up the keyboard shortcut section. If you hit Command Option Spacebar, that'll bring up the emoji picker and you can scroll through all the emojis. You can search for them. We'll just type LOL. There we go. And now you have an emoji. That's really excellent. If you want to force quit an app. Like you can of course go over here and right click. And then if you hold option, you can actually force quit. So holding the option button down just while you're looking at things is always an interesting thing in macOS. It sometimes shows new options. But you can also bring up the force quit interface, which is command option escape. Yeah, there we go. And this shows you your open apps and you can click any of these, force quit, and it force quits the app for you. If an app is actively not responding, it'll show red text here next to it so you know exactly which one is causing an issue. And finally, I can't show this one without breaking the screen recording, but if you want to lock your screen really quickly, it's Command, Control, Q. That'll bring you right to the lock screen. You'll have to enter your password to get back into your Mac. Okay, so everything we've looked at so far is built into macOS, is totally free, but there's a couple apps that I think add things to macOS that are so essential, I wanted to call them out here as well. I really love these. You can use them if you want. Obviously, you don't have to, but some really cool things. Number one is 1Password, which lets you sign into any app with your password manager, which is not a thing macOS has built in the way it does on iOS and iPadOS. So from here, I want to log into Sketch. I hit Command-Shift-Spacebar to bring in up 1Password's kind of system-wide thing. It detects Sketch is what I'm looking at, and I can hit the keyboard shortcut if I know it, but I can also arrow right to see all the actions. Autofill is here. It's going to autofill my username and password. It's even going to do my two-factor code, and now I'm logged into the Sketch app. Next up is Bezel, which is a way to just kind of share your iPhone's screen directly to your Mac. This is great for video calls. If you're sharing your Mac screen, it's a lot easier than trying to join the call with your iPhone and share your screen to the call from there. Just do it from here. It's really nice, really simple. You can customize the look to match whatever computer you have or whatever device you have. There's some other settings here. If we go to the menu bar item, go to settings, a couple things here, but very simple app. But if you share your screen and want to share your iPhone screen quite often, this is really useful. Then there's CleanShot. I've made numerous videos about CleanShot. I've worked with CleanShot before, full disclosure, but I use this as a full replacement for the screenshotting tool built into macOS. It's totally customizable. It has annotations built in. If I want to mask out the date, I can do that. I can change the amount of masking there. I can do arrows. I can do text. Hello. I can change the size of the text really easily. I can move it around. I can save it. I can copy to my clipboard. I can save it. I can upload it to the cloud. Billion things here. I've made other videos about this, but love CleanShot X. Next up is a clipboard manager, and there's a whole bunch of these. I use Pastebot because it's fast, it's reliable, and it was a paid upfront app for like 10 bucks or something, and I can just use it forever. And basically, the issue that it solves is if I copy this, paste this, and then I copy this line and paste it down here, hello world is gone. It's just completely gone. I can't get it back. And that's not a problem in this case, but sometimes it's not easy to copy that thing that you copied a couple seconds ago or a couple days ago even. And so this is where Clipboard Manager comes in. So if I want to paste hello world again, and I don't have access, let's say this is gone. If I want to paste it again, I hit Command Shift V, which is the keyboard shortcut I've set up. And hey, hello world is there. I can hit that and there it is. You can also see if I bring up the interface again, you can arrow through some of these other things. That screenshot is here. So images, videos, files, that'll all show up in the clipboard manager and it just gives you a history of what you've copied, lets you paste it again, which is really great, especially if you're like, what was that thing I was looking at yesterday? Really awesome. There's privacy settings here, so it doesn't save passwords in here. It can expire after a certain amount of time, however long you want it to save, and yeah, super awesome stuff. Okay, and last couple ones here. If you want to uninstall an app, again, there's a bunch of ways to do this. I think Raycast does this really well. Let's say I want to uninstall any type. We're going to go ahead. You can just drag it to the trash and that'll get rid of the application, but some library files, some other things will stick around. So in Raycast, I can type search for any type, and I can hit Command K to bring up the options, and we're going to type uninstall. Uninstall the application, it's gonna find the other supporting things. It's gonna make you enter your password to confirm this. And there we go, it's uninstalled the app, including the supporting files. And for these last two, I'm just going to show you the apps very, very quickly. The Unarchiver is super essential if you want to be able to extract any file type basically on the internet. There's a whole bunch here that the archive utility built into macOS won't do. This is really awesome. There's some settings you can set here as well, but this is an essential. It's free on the Mac App Store. And then the last thing that I'll recommend is everyone should have a plain text editor. I recommend Visual Studio Code. It's completely free. It's open source. You can see I've got this stuff here, but super full featured, but also very simple if that's what you need. It's the best text editor out there and it's totally free, which is great. There's other options if you want like Nova or something, but that's paid. There's a free one. Get this on your computer because a plain text editor is really useful more often than you'd think. And with that, we've reached the end of the video. Thank you so much for watching. This is probably a little longer than I expected, but I appreciate all of your time watching this. If you enjoyed it, again, drop a like down below, and I'll see you here next time. Bye-bye.